going to come here for trying to Q&A, so I don't know what I'm getting myself into. So my background is computer vision. I'm a research scientist at Google, been there for the last 6 years. And before this, I was at University of Pennsylvania doing traditional computer vision. And probably 4 years ago, I started getting into deep learning primarily. And since then, we have been doing myself and my colleagues a lot of work in computer vision using deep learning for a variety of computer vision problems, object detection, human pose estimation, image segmentation, and so on and so forth. So this is where I'm coming from and what my background is. So I'm happy to take any questions.
Yeah. Anybody?
It's all engineering. There is no biological inspiration. I think that many terms are inspired by biological things, and that's very misleading. Right? So everything is basically, you're building an engineering system, so it's all about optimization.
So what's the, you know, I'm coming from more traditional computer vision. It's something simple, like simple thresholding, counting, segmentation, all that. And what's now your take on 30 years of experience in segmentation, and all of a sudden, the machine learning taking over. I completely switched when I saw it in examples that we were working in our company, cell counting. So does this mean that the all this is obsolete?
Well, I wouldn't say it's obsolete. It's we're all developing and learning. So there are a lot of lessons which were gained beforehand, which are used as an inspiration for. Should I repeat the question?
The people on stream, because we're streaming
sure.
Live.
So the question is whether traditional computer vision is completely obsolete or not. The computer vision prior deep learning, and we have learned a lot from 30, 40 years of computer vision before deep learning, and all these lessons, the intuition, has been carried over, most of it, to deep learning in the design of algorithms. For example, segmentation has been always a step towards solving more real tasks like, let's say, object detection. And before people were trying to solve segmentation, because that was considered as a stepping stone, now, it's not so that important, but still within the architectures which are used for object detection, there are a lot of pieces, components, which are very much inspired by the notion of object segmentation. Right, so.
I noticed that a lot of the computer vision techniques rely on like the digital image decomposition into like red, green, and blue. I was curious if you had any thoughts on like using hyperspectral information or in like a frequency domain rather than like just digital images as they're represented for humans as like allowing for more variability in how computer vision works.
So the question is whether we can use some spectral decomposition of the images and input instead of the traditional RGB. I haven't seen any work in this direction. I think that the earlier layers of a neural network, they're filtering, and filtering is basically going towards some spectral decomposition. Because when you do filtering, you compute coefficients in some Fourier domain. I know that in speech, people have been in the past using spectral features, which are now obsolete. They don't do this anymore. Right? So even in other domains where people have been hand engineering spectral features for recognition purposes, that has been pushed to the side. And just using the raw signal is what works best empirically. Yes?
Yeah, I saw you recently published a paper about pose estimation. Could you tell us a bit about the recent paper?
So the question is about human pose estimation. Yeah, so human pose estimation is an old problem. It's about just for those of you who don't know, it's about detecting the location of body parts in an image. And there is this branch of computer vision which has been looking at people, like problems which are really for people, because a big chunk of the visual data contain people, and we do care about analyzing people very well. And detecting key points is one major problem. Traditionally, human pose estimation has been playground for graphical models because the kinematic structure of the human body is very complicated. The possible poses, you know, it's a huge combinatorial space, and graphical models have been always a nice tool of decomposing this space in a manageable way. And probably like 4 years ago, we started looking at using deep neural networks, and the major ideas are very simple. You just use the neural networks as a function approximator from an image to a human pose. And in a way, the human pose estimation has been reduced to any other computer vision problems, where the neural network makes almost no assumption about the concrete problem at hand. In this particular case, human pose estimation, it just tries to output, you know, it's a general neural network with the general layers, and the image, the input is the image, and the output is some representation of your target, which in this case is the pose of the human in the image. And people have been, over the last couple of years, have been basically fighting in kind of working out the engineering kinks of making this thing work better and better. And all these papers, the most recent ones, are just assistance building effort where, you know, we sit down and figure out all the small things in the pipeline which make the performance higher and higher.
Any work on depth perception? I understand the images are mostly 2D right now, and it's kind of hard to figure out the depth part.
So the question is about depth perception from an image. Are you talking about using two images, stereo images, video, or just a single image?
I guess it's
either. Okay, so so depth perception from a single image is taken off probably five, six years ago. There was before deep neural networks. There was work by two people, one Andrew Eng in Stanford, and there was another guy whose name escapes me now. And the idea is that you can actually hallucinate depth from a single image, which is obviously a new pose problem. Right? From a single image, you don't have enough information to perceive depth. We have stereoscopic vision. Humans use two cameras and through triangulation we can estimate the depth, but in reality we do hallucinate depth. I mean, if you close one eye, you're gonna still see a 3D image. So at that time, people before deep learning, people were trying to, you know, come up with the idea, can we use machine learning? And at that point, machine learning wasn't so that mainstream in computer vision, so it was in a way a surprising result that one can get pretty meaningful depth from a single image. And since then, people have been doing this with deep neural networks in a variety of setups, and it has been working better and better. What more recently has happened is also improving stereo depth, so from two cameras estimating the depth, and also with neural networks we've seen superior performance. And I must say that's another testament of the strength of these models, because estimating depth from two images, from two cameras, is a problem which has been worked on for the last two decades, and the pre-deep learning methods were really, really very strong. And then beating them with neural network, which makes very little assumption about the geometric setup, it's quite impressive.
You talk about your experience in getting into deep, like what the key points?
Well, it wasn't so hard because, so how did it start? I mean, I work at Google, so machine learning has been always very mainstream within the company. So there were a lot of people just looking at various machine learning methods. And I think 2012, there was this Toronto paper which started the whole thing, and there was actually an intern who is currently at OpenAI, who was an intern at Google, and he, as a side project, re-implemented this paper and this method, and it was part of image search. And it was working surprisingly well, and everyone was surprised, and that thing basically, you know, excited me and inspired me, and we started slowly looking into these problems. And one One nice lesson was it's really beneficial to work with people who are very complementary to your skill set and who are even not part of your field. And you might consider sometimes their comments quite, you know, unqualified, but these people give you a really nice perspective. And this was, you know, in this case where machine learning people are coming and don't want to think about vision, they don't want to think about the existing algorithms, but that gives them the ability to come up with crazy ideas, which you'll never think of. And they just start working better sometimes. So that was a major, you know, major influence, working with people who are not computer vision experts.
What are the traditional methods before deep learning and you start using machine learning? What are the traditional methods?
So the question is about the traditional methods in computer vision. That's a good question. So, I mean, it's not like black and white traditional and non-traditional. So historically, the problem of recognizing objects, scenes, things in an image is a relatively new problem. It started being addressed early 2000s. 2003 was the first data set released which was allowing to test such methods. It was done by people at Caltech in Southern California. And at that point, it became clear that machine learning can be used in computer vision. These were the first approaches where people were using machine learning. And that was kind of the tradition. And before this, everything was geometry, or most of it was geometry. Understanding, basically, coming up with mathematical model, which explains the 3D world, which you perceive through the measurements given by the camera. So that's like the pure traditional computer vision. And at that point, people started defining the problem of recognition, which made many people very uncomfortable because it was way less formal than the mathematics of 3D reconstruction and the problem of recognition of recognizing classes, classifying images, objects, and so on and so forth. And that problem invited use of machine learning. This was 2003, and then 2012 is where machine learning became deep learning. Right, so, and before deep learning, machine learning was primarily hand-engineered features with some linear classifiers on top of them. And these linear classifiers were the machine learning piece. And the features were very much inspired by what people thought it's important to capture in an image. And if you look at these systems, they're in a way very similar to deep learning because the feature extraction has been always some type of filtering and then quantization. So the filtering is like a layer, quantization is like mass pooling, and then on top of this, you have a linear classifier, which is like another linear layer. And now deep learning is basically doing this to the extreme where you learn everything and you have many, many of these steps instead of just two. Right, so it's not like black and white, it is, you know, a slow transition historically. And now with these deep learning methods, people started abandoning any mathematical models of how we perceived the 3D world and started trying to learn everything with these generic function approximators called neural networks.
Back to my question.
Yes.
So you mentioned moving away from mathematical models to something that looks more like engineering. For someone who's a practitioner or a researcher, how it may be specifically what areas of math are still critical, and where do you see, let's say if you're working with someone who's more on the software engineering side, and where do you see them lacking in terms of mathematical modeling?
So the question is about what mathematics you need for deep learning. I think if you're going through the deep learning book, that should give you a pretty good overview. It's many linear algebra, I believe, and then you need some, I think it's called calculus for the optimization part. So this should give you a pretty good toolbox for handling all these methods.
Probability, thumbs up, thumbs down?
Of course, and probability is also important. Right? So.
What's your favorite paper from this year?
Oh, it's kind of hard to say what's my favorite. Ian Goodfellow was here, so you know, generative adversarial networks is a pretty neat idea which excited many people in the community, and a lot of people are just pounding on it.
Which one?
The idea of like generative adversarial networks. It's basically a quite better way to kind of address supervised learning, which has been a very open question in a sense. How do you use all the large quantities of unlabeled data we have, and generative adversarial networks is one thing which seems to be performing quite better than else people have ever tried. That's an old paper, it's like 2013, I believe, or 14, but it just took off this year. Yes?
Any other hyped branch of deep learning?
Underhyped branch of deep learning. It's hard to say. I mean, those things are really hard to say. If I knew what's on the head, I'll be working on it.
What about overhyped?
Overhyped?
Yeah, like something that's really cool right now, but you think there's no future in it.
I don't know, it's hard to say. I mean, there are a lot of things I wouldn't work on, but it's because my taste, in terms of like what I'm interested in. I think in general, it's very good that so many people working on deep learning, because there's so many ideas out there, and only a few of them are good, but we don't know which are good. So just people trying and doing the experiments is a really great great thing to do. Yeah.
So there's been some experiments with reinforcement learning,
yeah,
objective functions for text. Do you see that as something useful for images as well, or only really sequential data?
So it's a reinforcement learning for images. I'm not really familiar with this work. I am aware of. So reinforcement learning is really good when you have a delayed reward. And usually we don't have delayed reward in computer vision settings.
So what example would be when you have a function that's not differential?
Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay.
Yes.
Is that something that you see from computer vision that
Yeah, so there are a few areas where, for example, they're very much text inspired. So there is this general area of image capturing, right? So the problem is you have an image as an input to your system, and your system should produce a description of what's in this image in a natural language. And then you need basically to formulate an objective which says, if you produce a sentence, how similar the sentence is to the ground truth descriptions. And usually these metrics, or these distances, they're not even metrics, these similarities are not differentiable. And I think this is the same reason why they use them in text. But in general, I would like to say, for reinforcement learning, people should be start looking more at not having a single image in, and just some objective based on a single image. One should be looking more at autonomous agents, which operate in some environment. There is a context, there is a history, there is an interaction with the environment, and visual input is one type of input which comes over time. And then in this case, reinforcement learning is the way to formulate the problems there. People are starting to look at these scenarios, you know, in robotics in general. There are a lot of efforts in, it's hard to get into such scenarios, because just collecting data or even setting up an experimental environment is very infrastructurally heavy and time consuming. Currently, for most of the computer vision problems, you just have a data set, and that's okay. Yes.
I first kind of bumped into computer vision randomly working with motion capture.
Sure.
You know, people in a suit with the reflective markers and whatnot. And, I was wondering if you come across any of that, done any of that with respect to deep learning, maybe building new systems.
So the question is about motion capture and computer vision. So you mean to capture the full 3D mesh of the human?
Yeah.
Using
marker the systems, like convex hole, things of that nature.
Yeah, actually I don't know how they do this. mean, it's pretty geometric problem if you have markers. I mean, just aggregate information over time.
Like, you know, they're moving towards markerless system.
Yeah, so, okay, so there is a stream of work where they try to estimate from a video the full 3D mesh of the person, right? And, they don't use any markers, they just do it like the hardest way possible, just have the video. And there, you know, that's no problem. And I think that this year there were quite a few papers trying to do this using deep learning, right? So, and then again, the whole thing is very similar to all the other problems you just have. You use the neural network to do the heavy lifting of taking the image as an input and then producing something which looks like a 3D mesh as an output. But I'm not familiar with the details of these. But I've seen quite a few papers in this direction. Either a full mesh or skeleton in 3D. So the question is whether how does one consume video with neural network? So the video is a 3D volume, right? You have x, y, the width, height of the image of each frame, and then the time dimension. So if you think of it as a volume, you can use three-dimensional convolution to process the video. The problem with three-dimensional convolutions is that they're very, very expensive, so people don't do this. People have tried, but it's just computation is extremely, it's very heavy. So people have tried LSTMs to, I remember 2 years ago for video classification, and then you have basically neural network which consumes each frame, and at some point in this network it starts aggregating the information across time. But usually the first few layers are frame, they're just for a single frame, they don't depend on the frame before and after. And because they work with images, this was the time when people redefined LSTMs in a convolutional fashion. So in other words, there is like a small state vector per pixel, so to speak, and it depends on the pixel of the current frame, but also on the history. So this was one development which was inspired by video. But in general, frames to a great extent are just being processed independently up to a level, and then the information gets aggregated over time. Yes?
I think your paper about the image captioning, like Sparks, was one of the original papers in combining neural nets and for vision and text. And it seems there's a lot of work in visual question answering. A complaint about visual question answering is that the questions might be too easy. So if you say, like, what color is the ball, and there's a big red spot, how do you see, is there any, like, smartness in the models, or or the text or benchmarks are easy, or?
So the question is about visual question answering. So for those of you who don't know, visual question answering is, I mean, there has been work in question answering in general, in machine learning or natural language processing, where you have some kind of information, bit of information in form of a text, and then someone asks questions and the system should understand the question, understand the text and the answer. And this problem has been recently redefined in computer vision, where instead of text, you have an image and the question refers to something. And as you correctly pointed out, this problem is very ambiguous. Oftentimes, the question can be answered without even looking at the image in these benchmarks. Someone asks, what's the color of the tennis ball? If you say green and yellow, it's high probability it's correct, right? It's an issue because having a good definition of such problems is it's a challenging task in its own. people who spend some time defining benchmarks, and it's an iterative process where people look at the problem, look at these benchmarks, try to come up with algorithms, see the problems, and then redefine them. So that's one issue, the ambiguity of the questions. But even if you forget this part, even if you have an answer, just measuring the similarity of this answer to the correct answer, it's also oftentimes a very, very hard problem, because measuring the semantic similarity between two sentences, they might be using totally different words, but expressing the same semantics, we don't know how to do this. Currently, people borrow techniques from machine translation, which is based on overlap of words and their order. So your system might produce a sentence which answers your question, but in terms of words, may be very different from what the laborer has said is ground truth. And then in this case, it's only penalized. So that's another ambiguity of this problem. So I think people just need to read. There are at least 5 metrics defining similarity between sentences. And people don't agree which one is like the correct one. So the question is like, what am I interested in the long run? Well, I think robotics is something, working with autonomous agents is something which interests me a lot. I think that people have been looking in computer vision at images in isolation, and that does not address many of the interesting challenges we have. And it's a good time now to look at robotics applications, because we've seen that neural networks are pretty powerful in consuming any type of data. And so the methods which are used to solve a wide variety of problems, not only with images, but also with audio and text, are very similar. So building systems which consume all these different types of data becomes easier and easier, and robotics is a scenario where you have to do this. So just looking, and when I mean robotics, I don't mean just a robot walking around. I mean any autonomous system. It can be a virtual agent, so something which understand context, understand history, consume data over time. Like a self-driving car is another robot. You have, we have our assistant on our computer, is another type of autonomous agent. So looking at problems in the context of other problems, in other words, in computer vision beyond the images, that's something which is up and coming. It's a good time to look at. Questions about model architectures. I don't know about this. I mean, the model architectures have been. That's a good question. So people don't. How can I say? People have, I think, lost interest in. I mean, I wouldn't say lost interest, but there is less and less work on designing architectures. In reality, architectures used to be more colorful a couple of years ago than they are today in terms of variability inside. I think people the thinking is different now. People are looking more at optimization. In other words, they realize that designing an architecture is one part of the problem, but also like learning this architecture is a very big challenge. And learning architectures the right way, in other words, or they generalize, that they converge well, that's a very important problem, and it's highly under research. We don't understand. I mean, people don't understand optimization of neural networks. And recently, there are a lot of papers which are trying to give insight into optimization, and it just comes to show how bad our intuition is about such models, highly non-convex models. Most of the optimization work has been focused on convex models, which have been the workhorse of machine learning for a long time, with SVMs and such. So with people don't understand optimization of neural networks, and empirically they just try to gain intuition. And I think that's more focused now than coming up with new architectures. And reinforcement learning, as you point out, is up and coming, and that's another that's another type of machine learning which I would say it's comparable to neural networks 5 or 6 years ago in terms of the ease of using them. Right now you can download a convolutional network and train an image classifier. Everyone can do this on your laptop. 5 years ago it wasn't the case. It was a lot of fighting, figuring out all the details. Reinforcement learning is now in the same situation as convolutional neural networks were five years ago. It requires a lot of intuition and like really figuring out all the details yourself before you can make reinforcement learning. And people are basically trying to make reinforcement learning easier to work with, I guess, optimizing better most of the time, figuring out all the details to make this happen. So that's kind of one direction which people are looking at.
More questions, guys?
Yeah.
We're running out of time anyway before we get kicked out. Thank you so much for coming.
Of course, my pleasure. Well, thanks for having me.